குட் மார்னிங் ஆல்.
டுடே ஐ எம் டிஸ்கஸிங் த ரிமைனிங் டாபிக்ஸ் இன் த கான்டெம்பரரி மேனேஜ்மெண்ட். ஸோ நெக்ஸ்ட் ஒன் இஸ் சிஎம்எம், தட் இஸ் த கேப்பபிலிட்டி மெச்சூரிட்டி மாடல். ஸோ திஸ் இஸ் ஜென்ரல்லி யூஸ் இன் த சாஃப்ட்வேர் இண்டஸ்ட்ரி. தட் இட் இஸ் நத்திங் பட் இட் இண்டிகேட்ஸ் த பர்ஃபார்மன்ஸ் ஆஃப் த சாஃப்ட்வேர் கம்பெனி. ஸோ டிபெண்டிங் அப்பான் திஸ் சிஎம்எம் லெவல், த சப்போஸ் the development indicates, suppose the if the company is in a good position in the software industry, then it has a top rank. So why this CMM is important for software companies? Suppose the investors, those who are interested to invest in that company, invest money in that company, then there is a need of this CMM level. So those who are having the good level of a CMM, then ultimately people are interested to buy the shares of that company, and also shareholders are also share value is also increased, and also the investors are ready to invest money in that company. So depending upon the CMM level, so this is the major advantage of this CMM level. Okay, so capability maturity model is a collection of instructions an organization can follow with the purpose to gain better control over its software development process. Okay, so it is nothing but a collection of instructions an organization can follow. So what are the instructions that is developed by the CMM? That instruction should be followed by the organization for the purpose of to gain better control on its software development process. So every company must have some control on software development process. So without control, there is unnecessary delays are there, and also there is a waste of money and waste of time. So because of this, the instructions which is framed by CMM, then you have to follow that instructions and to gain a better control on your software development process. For that purpose, it is very, very useful. So the CMM ranks software development organizations in a hierarchy of 5 levels, each with a progressively greater capability of producing quality software. So the CMM ranks software development organizations in a hierarchy. There are 5 levels are there. CMM levels are 5 levels are there. So each with a progressively greater capability of producing quality software. So the main aim of CMM is to give better quality software to the customer, the main aim. Okay, so suppose the same, suppose I need a software for my organization, then I am approaching which companies? So those who are having the CMM level, that means which the levels of I am asking about, what is your CMM level, that company? So because I need some quality software from them. Okay, so then I am asking, what is the CMM level of your company? Then they said some rankings or some levels. Then depending upon that, I am giving contract or I start with a agreement. So I make an agreement with them, and I explain what are the requirements of my organization from my side. Then they are write everything on paper or record everything. Then according to my requirement, they are designing software for my organization. So it's at what base I am giving the contract to that software company, the level of the CMM level of that company, I am completely depending upon the CMM level of that company. Okay, so depending upon that, I am giving the contract to that software company. Okay, so just like that, anybody, suppose it is a big contract, suppose big project, then they definitely see what is the CMM level of that company. Even the government is also giving contracts to that companies only because they are also need some quality software from them. If you take an example of Cowin software. So Cowin software is developed by, I think, TCS. Okay, so now the software is attracted so many countries for vaccination. Okay, so I think some 16 and 18 countries are approached to Indian government how you develop this software, and please give demo, because we are also developing this type of software. So that is very helpful for vaccination process. So they need some support from the Indian government. Okay, so this is the credibility of the government and also the credibility of the software company. Okay, so the government is also the people, suppose the background people, those who are giving idea, suppose the government, from the government side, they are asking what are the, suppose they are giving requirements of that software. According to that, the TCS company is developing the software. Okay, then ultimately it's give good result. Okay, so now the vaccination process is going on smoothly. So, and everything is recorded. So, first dose and second dose. So, we are, suppose, and after that, after immediate vaccination, then when you are completing vaccination, then immediately you have to download the certificate also. Okay, suppose if you are traveling abroad, then this vaccination certificate is very, very important. So, because they are giving QR certificate, QR code certificate. Just suppose you went to any country, then they are scanned them. Your QR code, just they are scanned. So then they're getting your details, you are vaccinated or not. Okay, so this is very, very useful software for those who are going abroad and also those who are living in India. So because there is accurate data, how many are vaccinated, so there is no chance to deviation. Okay, so each level is described as a level of maturity. Those five levels are equipped with different number of instructions to follow. So each and every have some levels, and each and every level has explained, described something about the maturity of the software company. So according to that, we are giving some levels. We are developing some levels. So CMM levels. So level one, it is called as initial level. That is called as initial level. So at maturity level one, processes are usually ad hoc, and the organization usually does not provide a stable environment. So in this, suppose they are in a starting position, the software company is in a starting position, they are startups, suppose. So processes are usually ad hoc, and the organization usually does not provide a stable environment. Okay, so these are usually ad hoc, and the organizations usually does not provide a stable environment, because in the organization, there is no proper stable environment, does not provide any stable environment for the software development process. So this is a mistake of the software company, not the persons. Okay. So then level two. So level two is the repeatable. Okay. So level two is repeatable. So repeatable means at this maturity level two, software development success are repeatable. Suppose they're already success in some software development previously, then they're repeating again. What strategy they have to follow? Then they are repeating again and again. The organization may use some basic project management to track cost and schedule. So they are using some of the basic project management techniques to track cost and schedule. What is the cost of the product and what is the schedule of the product? They are developing in this repeatable stage. Then third one is level three, defined. So level three is the defined. So in maturity level three, processes are well characterized and understood. So in this level, processes are well characterized and also they are easily understood and are described in standards, procedure, tools and methods. And also they are described in standard procedures and also tools and also methods. Okay. So in this method, they are clearly well characterized and understood. They are very clear and also easily understand. And we are described in standards, procedures. We are developing a standard procedures and tools and methods for software development process. Then these are all used by the software company. Okay, so that is the level three defined. Then after that, level four is the managed. Okay, so level four, it is named as managed. So using precise measurement, management can effectively control the software development effort. Okay, so under this using precise measurement, management can effectively control the software development effort. Okay, so in this method, in this level, the software company having good control on their software development process, they are effectively done the controlling process of software development. Then in particular, management can identify ways to adjust and adapt the process to particular projects without measurable losses of quality or deviations from specifications. Okay, so after that, management can identify ways to adjust and adapt the process to particular projects. So how the projects are adjusted and how to adapt that projects without any measurable losses. What is main important point is without measurable losses. Okay, so minor losses is okay. So but the losses are at measurable level, that is difficult. So then without any measurable losses of quality or deviation from specification, what the specification you have to give, then you are completely follow that specification. According to that specification, you have to develop the software, and also you are giving the best quality and without any deviation. Okay, suppose without any deviation, what you have to set previously and what you are giving the specification, there is no deviation with the specification. Then level 5. So level 5 is the optimizing. So optimizing means this maturity level focus on continually improving process performance through both incremental and innovative technological improvement. Okay, so optimizing is nothing but it is one of the maturity level. Focuses on continuously improving process performance through both incremental and innovative technological improvement. So in this method, the performance improvement is continuous process. They are continuously improving the process of performance, and also they are using incremental and innovative technological improvements. Okay, so they are always innovative. Then suppose they are following new things, and also they are inventing new things, new technologies, their improvement, suppose the technology improvement is continuous. Okay, they do not stop anywhere. So they are continuously improve technological and also performance. Okay, technology and also performance, they are continuously improving. Okay, so this is the level 5. So those who are having the level 5 companies, suppose the level 5 ranking, then ultimately these companies will be treated as a good companies. Then level 4, level 3, level 2, level 1. So level 1 is a least one. So level 5 is the topest. So 5 is the good ranking, 4 is also good ranking, and 3 to 1 is comparatively slow ranking, suppose less rankings. Then level 4 and level 5 is okay. So both are considered as good ranks. Okay, so this is about CMM. Then next one, SCM, supply chain management. This is also one of the important thing nowadays. So supply chain management, then you have to see this diagram, then you are easily understand what is the supply chain management concept. Then after that, we have to see the theory part. So then first you have to see where it is started. Supply chain management is started from raw material. So we are collecting the raw material. So first basic need is the raw material, where it is there, where it is available. First you have to identify where it is available, that is the raw material. And after that, second one, you have to identify the supplier, the raw material is supplied by the which persons and which suppliers. Then you have to identify the supplier, and after that, third one is manufacturing. So after that, you are collecting the raw materials from the manufacturer supplier, then you have to go for manufacturing process, that is factory, that's indicating the factory symbol. Then after that, you have to distribute. After manufacturing, you have to distribute the product to the destination, that means the customer. Then after manufacturing, you have to follow any distribution channel. So already we are discussing in the marketing management. So how to use any type of distribution channel, airways and cargo or normal. So air cargo or normal cargoes. Then you have to deliver with the road transport or air transport. Then after that, it deliver to retail location. So suppose retailer site, that means retailer store. And after that, it reaches to the customer. Okay, so the customer is placing order online. So that's why it is indicated with the laptop symbol. They are putting laptop symbol. So so you have to use the airlines for international export. Suppose you have to export something to some other country, then you have to use the airlines also. Okay, then after that, finally it reaches to the customer. Okay, so this is supply chain management. The total process is called as supply chain management. Okay, so where it is started, collection of raw materials, identifying of raw materials when up to customer, then it is on cycle, complete cycle. This is called as supply chain management. Okay, so how to supply the product to the customer, how to reach the customer. Suppose the product is how to reach the product to the customer, that is main important thing in the supply chain management. You have to manage all these things in an efficient manner, then only you have to give timely delivery to the customer. So that is very, very important thing. So supply chain management. So supply chain management is the optimization of a products, creation and flow of from raw material sourcing to production. Okay, so from where it is started, raw materials, you have to collect the raw materials and logistics and delivery to the final customer. Finally, you have to deliver the product to the customer. Okay, so then SCM encompasses the integrated planning and execution of processes required to manage the movement of materials, information, and financial capital in activities that broadly include demand planning, sourcing, production, inventory management, and storage, transportation or logistics, and return excess or defective products. It is a long sentence. So we have to explain in a brief manner. So after that, SCM is integrated planning and execution of process. Okay, so it is nothing but a processes required to manage the movement of materials. So in this way, you have to observe the movement of materials. So materials are, suppose you have to take the initial stage, step one, then how they are moved to step two, and how they are moved to step two, and step three, step four, step five, like this. So you have to observe the materials movement, and after that, information and financial capital in activities. Then after that, another important thing is information regarding process, manufacturing process, and also financial capital in activities. So what are the financial requirements for activities that broadly include demand planning. So they are broadly including the demand. Suppose you have to plan the demand. So how much demand our product is having in the market. That is one of the important thing. So demand planning. So and sourcing. So sourcing means, so where suppose raw material. So source is nothing but raw material. How to produce the, suppose how to run the production process without any raw material, you are unable to produce anything. Suppose that's the purpose. The sourcing is important, raw material. Then the production. So after that, you have to production, you are going to production. Then that means we are ready to produce the product. So that is called as production process. And after that, inventory management. So after that, you have to manage the inventory. That means how to store the raw material, how to transport the raw material, and how to return the excessive material, and all these are comes under inventory management. And the storage, transportation or logistics, and returning excess or defective products. Suppose if you have excess product or any defective product, you have to return them. So and you have to manage the manage the logistics and also storage, and also transportation. That is also important thing. So you have to focus on all these things. Then this is called as a proper management. Supply chain management relies on both business strategy, specialized software, and collaboration to work. Okay, so supply chain management relies on both business strategy. So it is focuses on business strategy and also specialized software and collaboration to work. There is a separate specialized software and also there is a collaboration to work. Okay, so this is called as supply chain management. And after that, another important thing in the contemporary management. So enterprise resource planning. So nowadays it has a wide scope, and also so many software companies are focusing on for developing ERP softwares. So some of the major important softwares are SAP. So SAP is the one of the most popular software, and Oracle also developing some software, Oracle ERP software. And so many companies, Windows is also launching some of the enterprise resource planning software. So, but from all these, most popular thing is SAP. So, because so many companies are using this SAP software, because it is customized. So, according to the requirement of the consumer, you have to change the program, and also you are giving better security through the SAP. Okay, so it is a highly security system. So there is no chance to enter into your network without your permission. So then that is very, very important thing. So under this ERP, so you have to plan the total enterprise. Then it integrate all data and processes of an organization into a unified system. Okay, so it integrate all data. That means any type of data. So different types of data are there. Department, suppose for having some HR department, finance department, marketing department, and sales and distribution department. So like this R&D. So we have so many departments. So then we have to gathering different types of, collecting different type of information from the different departments. So then after that, you have to integrate all these information. Have to collect the data from various departments, then you have to collect that. So then, so after that, a typical ERP system will use multiple components of computer software and hardware to achieve the integration for key integrated of most ERP systems in the use of unified database to store data. So data is very, very important. So ERP system is using multiple components of computer software and also hardware to achieve the integration for key ingredient of most ERP systems. So it is helpful to integrate the things. Then for key ingredients of most ERP systems is the use of a unified database to store data. So each and every ERP system will provide the facility of the unified database store data. Okay, so this is provided, this is the option is provided to the people who are monitoring the ERP. Then ERP systems cover all basic functions of an organization. ERP is also covering all the basic functions of the organization. So, and regardless of the organization's business, non-profit organizational, and non-profit organization, non-governmental organization, or government. Okay, so ERP systems cover all basic functions of an organization, and organizations, regardless of the organization business. So what type of business you have to follow, there is no need to the data. Then non-profit organization, so that is also important one though. And then non-governmental organization of government, so it is a non-governmental organization of the government. So these are all the important things in the ERP. So then after that, ERP applications automate and support a range of administrative and operational business processes across multiple industries. Okay, so ERP applications automate and support a range of administrative and operational business process across multiple industries, including line of businesses, customer facing, administrative, and asset management aspects of an enterprise. So you have to manage all these things. Then, so support a range of administrative and operational business processes across multiple industries. Okay, so you have to conduct you have to analyze multiple industries, and also multiple including line of business and customer facing and administrative and the asset management aspects of an enterprise. Okay, so you have to manage all these things. Then ERP deployments are complex and expensive endeavor. So ERP deployments are always complex and expensive also, and some organizations struggle to define the business benefits. So some of the organizations are unable to train, unable to define the benefits of the ERP. So the benefits of the ERP, that is another problem for the enterprise resource planning. So after that, another important thing is performance management. Okay, so performance management, all of you know that performance is nothing but those who are having the Those who are in the good performance, then you have to identify that persons and you have to encourage them. So, and we are also giving awards and rewards to that person. So, performance management is covered with communication. It is completely covered with communication. This is done by creating a climate in which a continuing dialogue between managers and the members of their teams takes place to define expectations and share information on the organization's mission, values, and objectives. Okay. So, personal management, so it covers with communication. This is done by creating a climate in which a continuing dialogue between managers and the members of their teams take place to define expectations. First, the managers and members are talking very freely. Then after that, creating a climate in which a continuing dialogue between managers and the members. There is a need of, because there is a communication, is suppose communication is very, very important. So you have to maintain a good communication with the, suppose the manager is maintaining a good communication with the members, and their teams takes place to define expectations and share information on the organization's mission, values, and objectives. And after that, they are clearly defined the expectations and share information on the organization's mission, values, and objectives. You have to define the expectations according to and based on the mission and the values and objectives of the organization, and you have to share the information also. Then this establishes mutual understanding of what is to be achieved and framework for managing and developing people to ensure that it will be achieved. Okay, so this establishes mutual understanding of what is to be achieved. Then they are clear, all the employees are having clear idea about the what is the achievement, suppose what they are achieving, and a framework for managing and developing people. And after that, it creates a framework for managing and developing. So people to ensure that it will be achieved. So all the people are working in a common direction how to achieve this one. Then next one is the definition is said by Ms. Armstrong Murlis. Okay, then after that, next definition is given by Fowler. So in 1990, performance management is about managing the organization. It is a natural process of management, not a system or technique. Okay, so it is nothing but about managing the organization, and it is a natural process of management, not a system or technique. Okay, so this is performance management. After that, business process outsourcing. So BPO is another important concept. So nowadays, software companies are majorly using this concept, BPO. Suppose they are contracting with some big company, they are giving the contract. So their time is not, they don't have some time. Suppose they are unable to produce or make something, then they are approaching the BPOs. So they are giving the work to the BPO. That means outsourcing, that is called as outsourcing. So in software industries also, there is a big projects are there. So the software company which are located in the different companies, they are suppose our Indian companies are making contract with them, and we are ready to do this project. Then how much time we are giving and what are the things, then they are explained. So BPO refers to a decision to subcontract some all or non-core processes. So it is nothing but a subcontract. Suppose I am the main contractor, I am giving some of the work which is suppose I got a big order. So then I am giving some outsourcing, some task is outsourced to some persons. Then this is called as a business process outsourcing. So the main motive for businesses process outsourcing is allow the company to invest more time. So they are the main advantage and main aim for this is allowing the company to invest more time. So with some other activities, suppose they don't have some much more time to manage all these things, then you have to outsource some of the works, then you have some more time to invest the company issues, then money and human resources into core activities and building strategies which fuel company growth. Okay, so after that outsourcing is also allowing human resources into core activities and building strategies which fuel company growth, that these are useful for company growth. The global market today is highly competitive and ever changing. So the daily market is highly competitive and there is no change. So a company must focus on improving productivity and yet cut down cost. So from our company side, you have to focus on the improving the productivity and also you have to cut down the cost. There is a lot of tasks that use up precious time, resources and energy are being outsourced. Okay, so there is a lot of tasks use up precious time. So resources and energy are being outsourced. Then you have to resource something. Then they are completing the task. BPOs are the units to which work is being outsourced. Okay, so BPOs are nothing but these are the units to which work is being outsourced. Are flexible, quicker, cheaper and very efficient. Okay, so the BPOs are doing that work in a flexible manner and quicker and also cheap cost, low cost. Okay, so BPO is contracting of specific business tasks such as payroll to a third party service provider. Suppose the payroll process is outsourced to some BPO, then they will take care about all the things regarding payroll. So BPO is often divided into two categories. There are two categories in the BPO. One is back office outsourcing, second one is front office outsourcing. So the internal business functions such as billing or purchasing, these are outsourced, then it is called as back office outsourcing. And front office outsourcing is customer related services such as marketing or technical support. These are outsourced, then it will be treated as front office outsourcing. Okay, so these are the two types of the business process outsourcing. Then after that, business process re-engineering, BPR, suppose is there any change in the environment of the organization, suppose is there any changes in the business environment, then you have to re-engineering the process of business, then only we are getting advantage from the external factors. So definition of this BPR is the fundamental rethinking and radical redesign of business process to achieve dramatic improvements in critical contemporary measures of performance such as cost, quality, service and speed. Okay, so there is a rethinking and radical redesign of business process. So we are redesigning our business process to achieve dramatic improvements. For what purpose? You have to improve. So you are getting some dramatic improvements in critical contemporary measures of performance. Okay, so in critical contemporary measures of the performance, such as cost, quality, service and speed, you have to improve all these things. This is definition is set by the Hammer and Champy. Then after that, BPR is a management approach aiming at improvements by means of elevating efficiency and effectiveness of the process that exist within and across organizations. Okay, so this is elevating efficiency and also effectiveness of the process, and that is exist within and across organization. Okay, within the organization or across the organization. And the key to BPR is for organizations to look at their business process, form a clean slate perspective and determine how they can best construct these processes to improve how they conduct business. So your organization, suppose if you have done a business, that will be is a clean slate. That means there is nothing in the slate. So very clean, it is very clear. So your business is also like that. Perspectives and determine how they can best construct these processes to improve how they conduct businesses. Okay, so after that, you have to give some suggestions and some education regarding this. They are also being like this. Okay, so this is business process re-engineering. So after that, the benchmarking and a balanced scorecard. So benchmarking. So benchmarking is a process of searching for identifying and using ideas, techniques and improvements of others' company situations in its own activities. So you have to compare, suppose quality, what type of quality we are giving and what type of quality your competitor is giving, which are the major competitors, suppose for your product, which are giving major competition in market. So then you have to select that one. Quality, your competitor quality, your standards, your competitor standards, your salaries, your competitor salaries, and your technology, your competitor. You have to compare all these things. So according to that, what we are, and then you have to get the awareness, and you are getting the information regarding your competitor. So you know the exact position of your business. You are in a better position or in a bad position, then you have to analyze with the benchmarking process. Okay, so a systematic and ongoing process of improving performance by measuring a product, service or process against a partner that has mastered it. Okay, so you have to analyze, have to compare with your competitor. So then after that, you have to analyze all these things. Is there any drawbacks in your side? Then you have to correct them and you have to improve that things. Okay, so in short, comparing methods against the best to identify changes. So in short, you have to identify what are the changes in the methods. Then a quality management tool that includes a set of practices aimed at improving product and service quality. Okay, that is the these are the two important things in the benchmarking. And after that, balanced scorecard. Balanced scorecards are like that. So it is clarify their vision and strategy and translate them into action. So you have to convert the strategy into the action. So suppose you have some vision and strategy for your organization, then you have to translate the strategy into the action. Suppose you have to develop the strategy that is converted into the reality. That means you have to implement that strategy in your organization. So it provides feedback around both the internal business process and external outcomes in order to continuously improve strategic performance and result. Okay, so you have to improve the strategic performance and you have to improve the business process. Then when full deployed, the balanced scorecard transforms strategic planning from an academic exercise into the nerve center of an enterprise. Okay, so the balanced scorecard transforms the strategic planning into from an academic exercise. So the balanced scorecard suggests that we view the organization from four perspectives, that is learning and growth perspective, business process perspective, customer perspective and financial perspective. These are the four perspectives are very, very important. Okay, so